My mother always keeps telling me that I have been a very terrible child. It is because of the restlessness and the fidgetiness I always had. So when you have a collar mic, this is an advantage. You can move around, you know. So I chose this because India is becoming a melting pot, because a lot of expats, people go from this country to other places, and then they bring back culture from other countries, especially the Middle East countries, from the Western countries. So basically we have a melting pot here. What I find personally disquieting is that, you know, in these we find that our resilience of the next generation, of the new generation that I am seeing, of children, adolescents, and even early adults, their resilience seems to be reducing. So I have been giving it a lot of thought as to why this resilience is reducing in a country which is known for its culture of resilience. The Hindu philosophy of life, Hinduism is not a religion as many people make it out to be. It is a philosophy of life. And in this philosophy of life, unlike what the universe has ever seen, there is so much of resilience, the ability to absorb everything. And that's why this country has so much of diversity, but the solidarity of diversity. You would never find that sort of a culture anywhere else in the world at any time in history. There is tremendous amount of this unity in this diversity. But that is changing. We are finding a lot of changes intrinsically within our framework of how our mind operates, as well as around us. The way we bring up children, the way education is handled instead of schooling. So basically there is a lot of change which are disquieting. So that's about our daily little battles of life, both extrinsic and intrinsic. That's my center where I do my practice. Now, this is a perpetual slide that I present even when I'm talking about empowerment of women. I show this slide because there's a lot of confusion about what psychiatry is. Psychiatry is a new science, it's a nascent science. Mind is generated by the brain. And psychiatry is today perceived and practiced as the application of basic neurosciences to man's day-to-day problems. So there is a greater integration of neurosciences, molecular biology, genetics, because the exponential research that has been possible today has made it possible for us to peep into live brain cells as they are functioning and strain and being able to see what those brain cells are doing in terms of neurological mechanisms in those brain cells, which produces the day-to-day problems. So therefore, psychiatry is a branch of medicine. Psychiatry disorders, therefore, today are beginning to be perceived as physical disorders, and psychiatrists are primarily physicians. These are the things that, as I said, disquiet me. And I'll just quickly allude to some of the philosophy of the extrinsic causes of my disquiet. One is an intolerant generation. All of you would, I think, agree with me that, you know, the society, the Indian society is beginning to be intolerant. We have a new generation which is turning intolerant. A generation of youngsters who are turning intolerant. Very difficult to get them under social controls. We have children who are intolerant of parents. We have spouses who are intolerant of each other. I don't like you, so I am walking out. This is not India. India was a time, India had a time when, you know, there is so much of tolerance that it is possible to actually talk to a couple for two sessions and three sessions and bring them together for life. Today it's not possible. I work with them very hard for 10 sessions, and then it still doesn't move on to resilience. So spouses who are intolerant of each other, and families which are interpersonally intolerant, brothers fighting with brothers, sisters fighting with their in-laws, there is tremendous amount of intolerance within the family. So today, thus, this emotional intolerance is the root of all emotional pain, which is sad. Because this, all of these are things that can be easily avoided. To have tremendous amount of pleasure in the act of life. Emotional pain does not these days dissipate like it used to before. In my home, when my father and mother would have a difference of opinion, there is transaction between them. There is tremendous amount of transaction between them. Or maybe my father would just keep quiet, or my mother would just keep quiet, and there is transaction between them. And there is dissipation of this emotional pain. It never happens now. It's all noise. And a lot of noise which you cannot, which you find difficult to actually wade through. And the second thing that upsets me sometimes is this loss of hierarchy. Hierarchy is something that has contributed enormously to this culture in India. If you look at the universe consists of several systems and subsystems, all of which exist on hierarchy. There are galaxies, and there are stars, and there are planets, and there are satellites, and you know, you have all these things which exist on hierarchy. And it is the hierarchy which holds the system together. We are seeming to forget that in our country, because somebody goes to United States for 10 years and he comes back and says there is no hierarchy there. It's non-hierarchical parenting there. Father is called by his name. That is not what we had in our culture. So when we have this dance of culture which holds hands with each other, I think it should be possible for us to look back into ourselves and see what the past has been, and then integrate what was being good in the past to what we have today. The loss of hierarchy, it has become an impediment to growth. It has become an impediment to peace. It has become an impediment to ethics in society. The loss of hierarchy. You look at the financial downturn which happened in the last end of last century. You look at the financial downturn, what happened? The Lehman Brothers, which was run as a tightly administered financial institution, which is the epitome of financial integrity and financial wisdom. The MBAs from Harvard walk in and they decide that there is no need for this. There is no need for hierarchy. So everybody had time to sit with this chauffeur and sit in the cafeteria and have a coffee together, or maybe even in the evening have a drink together, and the hierarchy was lost. If I tell my driver, oh, what a terrible woman I have married, that's the end of my relationship with the driver, and that's the end of his relationship of respect with my wife, and of course later his respect for me. We must have hierarchy. A hierarchy should be respect for each other. There is no doubt about that. But then we are losing this hierarchy. Because without mutual respect and blind trust, which is the root of every hierarchical system, today we are losing mutual respect. Today we are losing the blind trust that spouses had for each other, parents had for children. If the child said, I went to this place, you would know that he went to that place. We are losing mutual trust. Hierarchy should generate judicious transactions. As I said, these are sagacious, judicious, and with full of wisdom, transactions which actually improve inner discipline, which actually create inner discipline. Hierarchy creates inner discipline. That is what this culture had in this country. It creates inner discipline. It creates transactions which actually become meaningful and growth oriented. So our personalities grow, our relationships grow, the society grows. That's not happening anymore. The society is actually breaking down because we don't have inner discipline, which is the core in a disciplined family. In a structured family, we must have this core structure of inner discipline. It has to be inner discipline. It is not your mother having to tell you, look, do this or do that, don't do this, don't do that. It is not that. It is a choice. We help these children to give this, get these choices, and he chooses the right thing, and that is the inner discipline. And that sort of family is the cornerstone of an ethical society. Today we are looking after what have the Johnsons made in the next door, and ethics we have lost out. The family runs on different ambitions. So we are therefore turning into an anomic, an unethical, a disturbing, a disquieting, disturbed society. When I sit and watch this the news channels in the evening at 9 o'clock, it's so disturbing. I don't know whether you go through the same thing. We sit and watch a discussion for actually improving our information system, improving the discipline system, improving the structure of our society. Instead of that, you see the panelists shouting at each other. There is no hierarchy. The anchor has no role. There is no way in which you can have a discussion or a debate. Basically because the anomic society is what we are seeing today, with tremendous loss of hierarchy. So which is another thing that disquiets me. Hierarchy, as I said, entails mutual respect with subordination. The moment they say subordination, there are hands going up in a meeting. Subordination is not slavery. Subordination is a sense of, like for example, we saw so much of subordination here. I am subordinate to the president of the society. I am subordinate today here to the convener of the organizing committee. I am subordinate to her who has a tremendous amount of emotional acquaintance with me. So basically, in spite of all that, when this is happening, there is a resilience that is happening within me, and that creates subordination. This doesn't happen anymore because there is a wrong notion about the rights-based social change. Everything is rights-based. Now, I may appear to be antagonistic to several concepts that run across the world today. If you took a look at even child right, warning that I shouldn't be talking about. You look at child rights. A child's right is actually discipline. A child's right is good parenting. A child's right is the ability to assimilate the good things in life against the bad things. The good things in life against evil things. It doesn't happen anymore because it is determined by some societies that, you shall not firmly deal with your child. Whatever the child needs, you give. There is a tendency to give in. And this is misinterpreted by many, many parents as, having to pamper the children. Otherwise, they undergo tremendous pain in their hearts. Is this what the parents are taught today? And what happens to these children? They grow up without inner discipline. And so therefore, the rights-based concept should be properly understood. And that involves hierarchy. A properly understood hierarchy would produce a family with inner discipline. So therefore today what do we see? We see family structures which are allowed to disintegrate. Family structures which are allowed to disintegrate very easily. We should understand there are only two things at the end of the day. At the end of the day, when I go home after my work, at the end of the day, when I get home after my work, my wife should find peace and pleasantness. I should find peace and pleasantness. So all the rights that we talk about, without that responsibility to produce peace and pleasantness, all those rights don't mean anything. Our society is losing this today. So there is therefore a clear need to reconstruct a hierarchical interpersonal family and social system. And an authoritative system. It is not authoritarian. Please don't misunderstand me. An authoritative system is like the US president, even if you talk about Trump. The authoritative system is where there is hierarchy, there is discipline, there is inner discipline, but at the same time there is a tremendous amount of conference. You confer. So basically, if you look at the presidential system in the United States, it is a democratic system. But then, unlike the democratic system in India, where everybody is president, you have a president who confers. I'm sure before Bush went into Iraq, he consulted with all the secretaries, he consulted with his chief of staff, he consulted with his army, navy and air force, he consulted with everybody, and finally he made a decision to go in to destroy the weapons of mass destruction. It is important for us to realize that that is the way a home should work. That is the way which is authoritative and not authoritarian. And that is the way prudent parenting should take place. Parents have to have an authority across the children's inner discipline. And unless we have this, we lose hierarchy. And when we lose hierarchy, that is what happens. So today, without hierarchy, father is a friend, sort of fashionable parenting has come into India. I see this, I am practicing the United Arab Emirates. And I see this happening there so much that, you know, children are uncontrollable. There is no way in which you can monitor what they are doing. There is no way in which what drugs they are on. There's no, even here it's the same thing, probably worse. It's a little better because, you know, your contact systems are better, so you know what your son is doing. So there is a loss of hierarchy in parenting too. We learn from the Reader's Test, 10 steps to parenting. And we look at those 10 steps to parenting. We don't look at the hundreds of years of generational parenting that have gone, that we have gone through in this country. Every science is about replicability, is about repeatability. Every science is finding the truth when you repeat the same experiment. Our country has experimented with the system of family, a system of bringing up children for years together, for generations and generations. And the nectar of all this wisdom is what we have seen in our previous generations, our last generations, the generation before that, but it's all disintegrated. Today, what are we saying? We're talking about father should be a friend. If the father is a friend, then why do you need other friends? Father is a friend, then what? How can the father influence the thinking of the child? I had a father who came in after the last plus two examinations. The board examinations here in Kerala. And the father comes and says, you know, doctor, I am not like other fathers. I said, what's different? He says, you know, I am a friend to my children. I said, fine. How are you, your friend? You know, my son passed his plus two and I treat him like my friend. So he is 18. He is a major. So both of us sat down together and we have a pint of beer every day. That is his sense of father being a friend. And this is our problem. This is our problem in interpreting what friendship is and who should be a friend. So the man who thinks that is being a friend to his son, and his interpretation is that, you know, the son should have all the liberty to come and tell him his problems. And what does the son do? The son goes and takes pictures of a girlfriend and morphs it and puts it on the social media. And that's the reason why he was sent to us by his education institution. So you can imagine what
the lack of hierarchy would produce when you have non-hierarchical parenting, when you talk to a parent as a friend. What children need is not love. I keep saying, like generations that have come up, that have gone through in this country, what children need is discipline. What children need is not the expression of love. Love should be in a heart, and that's for the Lord to see, is what I personally believe. I brought up 3 children, and I have not expressed so much love, but the bonding is exceedingly good. And that's the sort of bonding that you'll have. I can explain it when I have time. So we need that sort of parenting through limit sets. And limit sets are firmness in parenting. Constant, morning, noon and night. Consistent, father, mother, grandfather, grandparents, uncles, and the teachers, and the doctors, everybody should be firm. We are only talking about firmness. And there is a Lakshmana Rekha that is associated with it. Those from abroad may not know this Lakshmana Rekha. Lakshmana Rekha is a line of control. A line of control that was established in one of the epics in the Hindu philosophy. Lakshmana Rekha is where you don't cross that line. One of our legends wrote a book on which he talks about Lakshman Rekha, where it has enormous philosophical implications. This is a line of control. Now, when you set limits for the children's behavior, the children's thinking process, if you let the child cross it once, then you think of the tragedies that would follow his later life, starting from his adolescence. So in order for that not to happen, there are limit sets that you have to teach the children when they are small. And that is another reason which I get upset. There is a tremendous amount of so-called fashionable parenting that comes in. Parenting is with personal space. That is the traditional teaching of the Indian culture. The traditional Indian culture is that the personal space between parent and child, it creates that Lakshman Rekha, the line of control. You don't cross this line of control. And the line of control is not saying that you do this or you don't do this. That is an inner control which the child chooses, as I said before. Because the qualities that have been put into him while he was being parented, and the subsequent family bonding, which is very important. In the process of creating this Lakshman Rekha, in the process of creating this inner control, you don't do away with family bonding. It's very important to have this family bonding. I do not know whether you all are aware of Matru Devo Bhava, Pitru Devo Bhava, Guru Devo Bhava. How many of you have heard that from India? You understand this meaning? Would somebody like to tell me? It is not like Mata Pita Guru Devo. It is not like saying mother and father are gods. It means mother should become God. Father should become God. And how do you become God? You become God by the personal space that you keep between the deity and the devotee. If you go to Chattanikira temple, I belong to Chattanikira. If you go to Guruvayur, you cannot go to the feet of the deity and touch and then put your hand to the heart. There is a personal space. There is a sanctum sanctorum. There is a personal space. You only get to see the deity in a flash. But what you see, you absorb and you put it in your head and it stays there. So every time you go to visit the deity, there is a bond that grows. Because there is a personal space. And relationship, therefore, with that personal space, which should be like a good fire going, with spaced logs of wood. Many of you would have gone to a campfire. If you want to have a good campfire going, if you want to have a good fire going with two logs of wood, you don't put those two logs of wood together like that, do you? If you put two logs of wood together sticking like that, you will not get a good fire going. You have to have space between the two logs of wood so that there can be oxygen, there can be breathing space, there can be good fire going. And this is true about every relationship. As I said, if I talk to my driver about my wife, I lose that personal space. Even between parents, even between parents and children, between teachers and students, between employer and employee, as I mentioned, or doctor or patient, or therapist or client, this personal space has to be there. And that is what gets us results. If you cross that Lakshman Rekha between therapist and the client, you know what will happen. So basically, it's very important for us to have this concept of personal space. So parents are therefore not friends. Parents are parents. And there is this personal space. There is a saying in Malayalam, Onne ullengile olakkikku kutti valarum. Any Malayalis here? Okay. If you have only one child, you must keep him at a distance of a pestle that we used to use in the previous generations to powder rice. This is a long pole. So parents used to tell us when we have children, keep them at arm's distance. Don't let them get too near you emotionally because they will emotionally manipulate you. All children manipulate. Starting from 2 years, they manipulate. If they can't get something done with their father, they'll get it done from their mother and vice versa. If they can't get it done from father and mother, as happens all these in the present times, they'll get it done from their grandparents. Which is why we say that there is this personal space and then we should not be friends. And that brings me to my point of the need for an ethical society. An ethical society is constructed by traditional parenting. When we grow, we have the choice to choose the right and the evil. If you have to choose the right over the evil, then we must have an ethical society which should come through traditional parenting. Traditional Indian parenting is what I mean. And traditional parenting, this is a very major important note I would like to make, because I see people smiling when I make this point about the parenting with hierarchy. I want to emphasize on this to those people who smile, that traditional parenting is without punitive measures. Traditional parenting is without shouting, without yelling, without screaming, without pinching, without beating, without bribing, without bullying. There should be no punitive measures. Parents who sit in front of me, most of my work is in child psychiatry. Parents who sit in front of me ask me, if you don't shout, if you don't scream and yell, they don't obey. If you scream and yell to make a child obey, then you will have to actually scream and obey to make it, to scream and yell to make him obey every time. After some time, you lose that control. Then you have to pinch and beat him. After some time of pinching and beating, he will start pinching and beating his younger one. And after some time, when he grows older, he will start pinching and beating his mother and father. This is what we see in today's world around us. I see this in my clinic every day. Where mother comes and says, you know, doctor, I can't suffer his violence and aggression at home. I had a mother who was tied to her bed and beaten up with a cricket bat. This is the way our friendship parenting is going on. All she had to do was see to it that whenever he made a mistake, report it to his father who was abroad. And both of them together as one unit. Parenting should be unitary parenting. Both father and mother should form one unit of discipline, which is not done. So when you wanted something, When he wanted a mobile phone with a camera, when it was refused, this is what the mother got. So we need to have this traditional parenting without having to shout or yell or scream or pinch or beat, without having to bribe, if you do this, I will buy you this telephone, without having to bully, if you don't do this, this is what will happen to you. Without having to do all this, then how do you do this? That's why I keep saying, you look at the deity and the devotee. The deity and devotee, after several years of this relationship of deity-devotee relationship, there is a bonding. So when you think of evil, when you think of bad, something triggers off in your head that you are a devotee. There is a way in which the deity would expect you to behave, and there is an inner control that spontaneously comes. The central executive, which is the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex, it impresses on the thinking process, on the cognitive process, that this has to stop. So that's how the control occurs when there is a deity-devotee relationship of that sanctum sanctorum personal space, which should happen with us. My father, I remember, with a lot of gratitude, never raised his voice in the house, because he never had to, which is the more important thing. He looks at me in my eyes, I trembled. So this is the reason why when I grew old and he grew into an old man, he suffered from cancer for 4 years. We had a bonding which is unbelievable. I was even willing to give up my job and look after him. There is a bonding that is so profound that I was even thinking of giving my job. You think of today's children, how they would look after their parents and grandparents. Right? So basically we are looking at a bonding when there is discipline, when there is this parental personal space, there is a greater bonding and there is a greater relationship. And that is what we need, without having to resort to punishment. I come to the second part of my presentation. How many more minutes do we have? Why? Let me quickly go through this. The Gita is a book of answers. It is a book of transaction. It is where Bhagavan and his friend, the mentor and the friend, they sat down together and found answer to every life problem. Physical, emotional, intellectual, philosophical and spiritual. So you have answers in the Gita, not only metaphysical but physical, not only afterlife but current life itself. And that's the most important thing. How do you live today's life? It is the greatest paradigm of behavior therapy, because it has been visited and benefited by millions of people who resorted to this advice in the Gita. And across millennia, it's not, as I said, the repeatability, the science, it has become a science because it's been repeated over the years. Restructuring the way you think about anything. You change the way you think about things. That is about the Gita. And that is therefore a best hand manual in the best practices of any therapy, including transaction. So, I would, if you can give me 10 minutes, I'll just quickly go through that. Is that okay? Or I'll wind up with, you want me to wind up?
We have some.
Yes, I understand. The thing about Gita is about Arjuna is a warrior. Arjuna is a warrior. The first chapter of the Gita is called Arjuna Vishada Yoga. And Arjuna goes to the battlefield and sees the battlefield. Like a child who goes to his examination hall the day before the exam. He goes through enormous amount of anxiety. He goes through enormous amount of anxiety in such a way that in chapter 1, which is called Arjuna Vishada Yoga, in chapter 1, verse 28, 29, 30, 31, when you read, you will find tremendous amount of anxiety, chest discomfort, choking sensation, dryness in the mouth, body becoming warm and hot and hands becoming cold and clammy, and knees buckling, and he losing his bow and arrow from his hand and falling, he falls down the chariot. He says, I can't fight this battle. I cannot fight this battle. This is what happens to people who come to us in front of problems, in front of their difficulties, when they are faced with exams. When a child who has to take 10 chapters in the exam and he has done only 5, in the day before the exam, he says, I can't take this exam, I have palpitations, I have heaviness in the head, I have headache, I have tummy pain, I am going to vomit. What do you do? Child says, I am not going to take tomorrow's exam. So this is the story of the Bhagavad Gita. The story of the Bhagavad Gita is about teaching us the intrinsic battles of life. The intrinsic battle of life is about the child not being able to face this stress. The intrinsic battle of life is about any of us not being able to face the stress that is coming on tomorrow. Because we have so much of anticipatory anxiety. What we need to do about tomorrow is to anticipate but not get anxious. But most of us, we anticipate, we expect the worst to happen and get worried, and our performance is taken away. So what does the Bhagavan do? He teaches through a discourse. This is not advice. So Gita Upadesha probably is a misnomer. It is not advice. Through a transaction, through talking to each other, through a discourse of questions and answers, Bhagavan teaches Arjuna 2 small things in the battle of life, in the intrinsic battle of life. I will quickly go through this and wind up. One is sthita prajna. The second chapter talks about sthita prajna, tranquil equanimity. There is a need for us to control our emotions. It's our emotions that are actually stopping our growth, our emotional growth. You have seen this picture of Bhagavad Gita where there are 5 horses. There are 5 horses. You know this picture? The 5 horses are supposed to be the panchendriyas, the 5 indriyas. But to me, Philip John's interpretation of this is actually from the roaming 5 indriyas. I have taken it down to the 5 negative emotions: tension, sadness, anger, frustration, and despair. I keep saying, if you don't have tension, then you won't work harder. If you don't have sadness, you won't have humility. If you don't have anger, you won't be able to control your environment and your workplace. If you don't have frustration, again, you will not work hard enough and coordinate with other people to take your life forward. If you don't have despair, you will not call upon the Lord. So when you have all the 5 horses, if one horse runs in one direction, you get so anxious about your exam, that horse runs in one direction, your chariot will not go forward. If you let one horse go in the other direction, you get desperate and you slump in the wallows of self-pity, your horse will not take you forward. So what does the Bhagavan do? The Bhagavan says, I am the charioteer. Bhagavan is, there is Bhagavan in every one of us. In every one of us, in our intellect, there is this part called cognition. Cognition, which is controlled, as I said, again by the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex, which does the thinking process. And that Bhagavan in us is not seen in animals or trees or plants. And that is cognition. So what do we do in cognitive therapy? What do you do when you do psychotherapy? What do you do when you do transaction analysis? You change the way you think about things by using this cognition, which is sitting in you, in your brain. And that takes your life, Arjuna's life, forward. Arjuna's chariot, Arjuna's life forward. So it's important that you must rein in all your emotions. And when you rein in all these negative emotions, they are not negative according to me, they are all positive. When you rein them in, when you control them, they are all positive. They together, all of them together will take you forward. And that is tranquil equanimity. So the first prerequisite to win the battle of life is tranquil equanimity. You must have that stability of mind which is peaceful. And the second is karma yoga. All of you are familiar with karma yoga. Karmani Vatikaraste Mahaleshu Kadajana. You do your duty to the best of your ability. Having had a tranquil equanimity, then you go on to action and karma. Because only if you are comfortable and peaceful can you actually put out your best. Your best performance comes when there is no anxiety. So the karma yoga is for dealing with the extrinsic, and that will take you forward to put out the best in you. And that is how Bhagavan has said, this is how you actually handle your extrinsic struggles of life. Your extrinsic struggles of life need two prerequisites. One is tranquil equanimity, is the prajna, and the other is karma yoga. Karmani vatikaraste mahaleshu kadajana. We all worry, as I said, anticipated worry. We worry that things are going to go wrong. When we worry, the worry takes away performance. So the Bhagavan says in chapter 2, verse 47, Bhagavan says, you do your karma to the best of your ability each day without worrying about the, without desiring for the result. So relentless, desireless action is karma. Relentless, without any break, you keep on working hard irrespective of the frustration that you undergo. Relentless, desireless. If you don't desire for a result, that is not for you to give. The result is for the Lord to give. You do your duty to the best of your ability each day. The result is for the Lord to give, and therefore your result will come according to His decision, and that's it. So, karmani vatikaraste mahaleshu kadajana. You do your duty to the best of your ability each day, and the Lord will give you the result. If you do not desire for the result of success or failure, if you do not worry about it, your performance will be the best. I thank you for your attention. I hope this will go a greater length to take on the struggles that encompass our society today. The difficulties that we have with cultures crisscrossing without our understanding of each culture in depth. So basically, we are looking at cultures from outside. I think these sort of conferences would help us look at cultures from within. I hope for this, I wish this conference a grand success. Thank you very much.